So friends, over the next 35 to 40 minutes, we shall talk a little bit about oxygen therapy. Little bit because it's not possible to cover everything in 35 minutes. And because of this pandemic, everyone seems to know everything about oxygen therapy. But for us, it has been always a very important topic. So you can see this is a picture of a cascade. So from this, the oxygen cascade refers to the series of steps of oxygen from the atmosphere right up to the mitochondria of our cells. And in this, the several steps that are involved in this cascade, in every step, there is some reduction in the partial pressure of oxygen. So it is also that reduction in the partial pressure of oxygen at any stage will lead to the decrease in partial pressure of oxygen in the subsequent steps. So reduction in PO2 at any stage, for example, because of hypoventilation, lung diseases, they cause reduction in subsequent steps and finally leading to the risk of inadequate mitochondrial partial pressure of oxygen, which is essential for aerobic metabolism. Now, this is the cascade. The dry atmospheric air, it contains around 160 millimeter of mercury of oxygen. And it is influenced by the barometric pressure. That means this pressure is true for at sea level. If you go higher up, this will be lesser. Now, once we inhale this gas, this mixture of gases, that is the air, it is humidified through the nasopharynx. And when it reaches the trachea, it is humidified. And the PO2 goes further down. From 160, now it is 150 millimeter of mercury because of the addition of humidity. Now, once it goes to the alveoli, it further falls down to around 106 millimeter of mercury. And this is influenced by the alveolar ventilation. If you hyperventilate, this will go further down. If you hyperventilate, it might be higher. Now, once it crosses the alveolo-capillary membrane to the arterial blood, it further falls from 106 mm of mercury to around 100 millimeter of mercury for a healthy adult. And this is influenced by ventilation-perfusion mismatch, or that is shunting. If there's more shunt, it will be lesser. And once this arterial blood reaches the capillary, the PO2 goes down to around 45 to 55 millimeter mercury. And this is influenced by the blood flow and the hemoglobin concentration. And once it reaches from the capillary to the cells and from the cells to the mitochondria, it is around 77.5 to 40 millimeter of mercury. So you can see that the cascade is the difference, the multiple steps right from the atmospheric gas to the mitochondria. And in every step, there is some reduction in the partial pressure of oxygen. Now an important concept is the concept of pressure point. What is this pressure point? It is the critical mitochondrial PO2 level below which aerobic metabolism cannot occur. So this much PO2 is essential for aerobic metabolism to continue. Otherwise, there will be anaerobic metabolism and there will be lactate formation, lactic acidosis. No one knows the exact value, but it is thought to be around 1.4 to 2.3 mm of mercury. Another important concept in which often short notes are given is oxygen flux. What is oxygen flux? It is also called oxygen delivery. So this is the amount of oxygen delivered to the tissues per unit time. And how to calculate it? You calculate it by multiplying the cardiac output with the arterial oxygen content. Now regarding the arterial oxygen content, we know that there are two important ways in which oxygen is carried in the blood. One is the major part is the oxygen that is bound to hemoglobin. And this is calculated by hemoglobin into multiplied by the oxygen saturation multiplied by 1.34. Now 1.34 is the ml of 1.34 the ml of oxygen bound to per gram of hemoglobin, and the oxygen dissolved in plasma is the 0.03 into PO2 in the partial pressure of oxygen, which is negligible. So in a healthy adult breathing room air at sea level, the oxygen delivery is about 850 to 1200 ml per minute or 500 to 700 ml per minute per square meter. Another important concept is the VO2, that is the oxygen consumption per unit time. One is delivery and other is the oxygen consumption.
Oxygen therapy.
And it is calculated by multiplying the cardiac output with the arterial and mixed venous oxygen content difference. You find out the arterial oxygen content and the mixed venous oxygen content, find the difference, and to that you multiply the cardiac output, you get the oxygen consumption. So it is around 240 to 270 ml per minute or 120 to 160 ml per square meter. Now our goal is typically ill patient, because oxygen delivery is there, but unless the tissues utilize that oxygen, it is of no use. So our goals is that we maintain a oxygen delivery of at least 600 ml per minute per square meter and oxygen consumption of at least 170 ml per minute per square meter. So this is the oxygen extraction ratio. It is the ratio of the oxygen uptake by the tissues, that is VO2, and the oxygen delivery, that is DO2, and it is expressed as percentage, so you multiply it by 100. Now coming to the indications of oxygen, we know that it is indicated in hypoxemia. And in the next slide, we'll see what are the different types of hypoxemia. And among the four different types of hypoxemia, oxygen therapy gives the best result in hypoxic hypoxia type. Then it is also useful in non-hypoxemic conditions like carbon monoxide poisoning, in post-anesthesia care. Now friends, one very important fact about this post-anesthesia care is that we usually give oxygen because after doing the recovery period of from general anesthesia, because of the, you know, the patient might hypoventilate, patient might develop diffusion hypoxia and all those things. But another important benefit of giving oxygen in the postoperative period is also that it reduces the incidence of soft tissue infection or surgical site infection. This you can get in the guidelines of the WHO. It is now oxygen also used in ER embolism and in compression sickness. Decompression sickness, not compression. So regarding the types of hypoxia, one is the hypoxic hypoxia, where the partial pressure of arterial oxygen is low, either because the patient is hyperventilating or patient is at a is getting a hypoxic mixture. Second is anemic hypoxia, where the PO2 partial pressure of arterial oxygen is normal, but oxygen content is low. Now, how can the oxygen content be low? Because we know that the major part of oxygen that is being carried in the blood is bound to hemoglobin. So and in anemic hypoxia, that hemoglobin concentration is low, so the total content of blood is low. The third is stagnant hypoxia, as we get in cardiac diseases like severe MS or in severe where ejection fraction is very low. And fourth is the histotoxic hypoxia, where the tissues are unable to use the oxygen. Utilize the oxygen because of some toxin, and the commonest is the, so among these you get when it is hypoxic hypoxia, there might be some benefit when you give anemic hypoxia, because it increases the amount of oxygen that is dissolved in the blood, little bit in stagnant hypoxia, but no benefit at all in case of histotoxic hypoxia. Now coming to the choice of oxygen therapy devices, there are several factors which need to be taken into account when we choose a oxygen therapy device. For example, age and size of the patient, oxygen requirement and therapeutic goal. If his oxygen requirement is high, we have to choose particular device. Very importantly, acceptability of a particular method of oxygenation. We might think of a particular device, but the patient might not accept it because of claustrophobia. Then we cannot give it. We have to think of some other method. So patient's comfort and acceptance is very important. And we should also remember that efficient and economical use of oxygen is important, because in the present situation of pandemic, where almost all the patients in the hospital are on some form of oxygen therapy, we have also to need to consider how much oxygen is being used. We cannot run out of oxygen. And of course, there should be minimal resistance to breathing. Now coming to the broad classification of the oxygen delivery devices, first there are two broad types. One is isobaric and the other is hyperbaric. We'll discuss them in details. Among isobaric, there are the variable performance devices. We'll discuss them. Fixed performance devices, we'll discuss them. High flow systems, we'll discuss them. In others, there are many. The commonest ones are the oxygen circuits, the Mapleson systems, the cardiopulmonary bypass systems, the extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. All these come under others group. These are all oxygen therapy devices, but we'll not discuss them. And among the hyperbaric, we have the single chamber or the multiplex. As I was telling, the two basic types, the isobaric and the hyperbaric. Isobaric oxygen therapy devices are those which deliver oxygen more than 21%, that is more than room air, but at ambient pressure, 1 atmospheric pressure. And hyperbaric devices are those which also give oxygen more than that is present in the room air, but at a high atmospheric pressure, more than 1 atmosphere. So we will discuss among the isobaric devices, we have the variable performance devices, fixed performance, high flow systems, and others, which we will not discuss. Now, whether a device is a high flow device, whether it is a variable performance device or a fixed performance device is based on one very important criteria, that is the whether the system can deliver gas at a flow rate that matches the patient's peak inspirative flow rate. If it can deliver the entire need of the patient's peak inspirative flow rate, then it is a fixed or high performance device. If it cannot, then it is a variable or low performance device. Now, there's a very important caveat here. A patient's peak inspirative flow rate is not fixed. It varies. Suppose a patient who is very dyspneic, who is breathing, who is tachypneic, in this patient, the peak inspirative flow rate may be very high. It may be 70, 30 liters per minute. And then under those circumstances, even a fixed performance device may not be able to match the patient's peak inspirative flow rate. And then it will start acting like a variable performance device. So this is a very important concept that you need to understand. How do you classify a variable performance device and a fixed performance device? And again, a fixed performance device may not remain a fixed performance device when the patient's peak inspirative flow rate is very high, which is very common in patients who are very dyspneic and tachypneic. So among the oxygen therapy devices, we have the variable low performance device, we have the fixed and high performance device, as I have just discussed. Now more about the variable performance devices, they do not provide the patient's entire ventilatory requirements. And so what happens? You are giving oxygen during the initial part of his breath, he will take that oxygen. But afterwards, a variable amount of air is entering. So the FiO2 that he is getting is variable. It's not fixed. It's not what you want to give. Among them, the very commonest one are the nasal cannula. The good thing is that it is comfortable, well tolerated. Patient can communicate, eat, drink, wear glasses, and read. But if you give at a very high flow, more than 4 liters per minute, there is nasal irritation because this is basically not adequately humidified. If the patient has got blocked nose, then the oxygen concentration that the patient receives might be lesser. And if you increase it more than 4 liters per minute, there will be no further increase in the FiO2 that the patient is getting. One very important thing is that people often ask, is there a reservoir here? Well, there is a reservoir. Our nasopharynx acts as a reservoir. And its volume is around 55 ml, very less, 55 ml, but still there is a reservoir. Another very common device is our Hudson mask. We can give a flow rate around 3 to 8 liters per minute. It can deliver an approximate FiO2 of 0.35 to 0.5. It depends upon the flow rate and the respiratory drive of the patient. We should not give flow rate less than 3 to 4 liters per minute because it may cause rebreathing of the expired gas. Then there are non-rebreathing masks available, which has got an oxygen reservoir. And there's a unidirectional valve system, which prevents mixing of the expired gases and the fresh gas flow. It may provide oxygen concentration of 0.6 to 0.8 with a flow rate of 10 liters per minute or more. But you should remember that it should not be used for long periods of time. It is only meant to be used to provide urgent or emergent but short time high FiO2. Patient is hypoxic. You are planning for intubation. Now, during this planning period for say 15-20 minutes, you can use them, but it should not be used for longer periods of time. Then the tracheostomy mask are there. That simple face mask used at the tracheostomy side. And you can give a flow rate of around 3 to 4 liters per minute to prevent rebreathing. Now, coming to the fixed or high performance oxygen therapy devices, they are so-called, as we have discussed, because they provide oxygen at a certain concentration. If you decide to give 0.5, they will most of the time deliver that 0.5. But as I have already told, predetermined oxygen concentration is available to patients unless the inspiratory flow rate is unusually high. If the inspiratory flow rate or the peak inspiratory flow rate is very high, then they might not provide the FiO2 that you desire. They provide a total flow, that means mixture of oxygen and air to fulfill the ventilatory requirement of the patient. The commonest one, as you all know, is the venturi mask. They act on the venturi principle. When there's a high flow of gas going, then on the side, there is negative pressure. You must have noticed that when a train crosses the station at a high speed without stopping, all the pieces of plastic and the air, they are sucked towards the plane, towards the train. So that is because that when the train goes, it creates a negative pressure and the air from the sides is being pulled towards the train. The same thing happens in the venturi mask. Through the orifice, we are giving oxygen, and since it is going at a high speed, through the orifices on the sides, through them, variable amount of air is entrained. And this gives a particular concentration of the oxygen to the patient. You can see that as we go from a lower FiO2 to the higher FiO2 ones, the side orifices become smaller. So lesser and lesser air is entrained and more oxygen is the patient gets. They are particularly useful when a definite FiO2 is to be given because we think that the higher FiO2 is deleterious to the patients. Like patients of COPD, where if you give a higher FiO2, then there may be hypercarbia. Now coming to the third groups, that are the high flow systems. High flow systems are very useful, more so in this pandemic. It has become a rage, and of course it has got some very important advantages, as we'll discuss. They've got few important components. One is the air and oxygen blender, and very importantly, an active humidifier, a single heated circuit, and nasal interface. This soft nasal interface goes inside the nostrils like the nasal cannula. It can deliver adequately heated and humidified. It is important. It is heated and also humidified. Otherwise, the patient will not tolerate. And you can give up to 1 liter per kg per minute or 60 liter per minute. And it reduces the need for intubation without affecting survival. When in many hypoxemic patients, if you can, they may not need intubation if they can tolerate this HFNO well. So these are different components. You can see the humidifier, you can see the circuit, you can see the nasal interface here. So this is one HFNO device that we have here. And this is the humidifier. It is important to have this humidifier functional. Then this is the nasal interface. Okay. Now, what are the indications of HFNO or HFNO? It is indicated in severe respiratory failure, and it is important that you use it in type 1 respiratory failure, that is hypoxemic respiratory failure. It is not very useful in hypercarbic respiratory failure. And how to determine when they need HFNO and the other devices are not working? When they are tachypneic, when the oxygen saturation is below 92% despite oxygen, high flow oxygen, and or the PF ratio is less than 150. Contraindications are few but very important. If the patient seems to be exhausted, or exhausted means he is breathing very rapidly but the breaths are very shallow. When he is confused, he is sweating, he is using his accessory muscles for respiration. He is getting a hypercarbic. Because of any reason, he is in altered mental status. In those cases, and patients with hypercapnia, there is exacerbation of either obstructive lung disease, or patient is having cardiogenic pulmonary edema, hemodynamic instability, multi-organ failure, then we should not use. In case of hypercapnia, it has been seen that there are data now which says that HFNO may be safe in patients with mild to moderate hypercapnia, which is stable. That means he's not worsening. In those cases also, HFNO may be used. There are certain very important physiological benefits of HFNO. It reduces the anatomical dead space, reduces the work of breathing. It provides a constant FiO2 and provides adequate humidification. And it provides a degree of PEEP. Because of the high flow oxygenation, the alveoli remain open. And so it produces some amount of PEEP also, which is beneficial in the oxygenation of the patient. The practical benefits that we as physicians get is that it is possible to use outside ICU. In the present day pandemic where there's shortage of ICU beds, even in SDU, you can use them. Awake proning is possible because the patient is otherwise alert, so he can prone himself. He can eat, drink, and communicate with HFNO. He can use the mobile also. So you can see with HFNO in place, the patient is eating. Okay, this is HFNO device. Similar to HFNO, which is used in ICUs, we can also use HFNO in the OTs. This is called THRIVE. THRIVE stands for transnasal humidified rapid insufflation ventilatory exchange. So what happens is that you use it similar to the ICU patients, but here the patient is apneic. That is, patient has been anesthetized and even a muscle relaxant has been given. So it is effective in prolonging the apnea time. So how does it help? It combines the benefits of classic apneic oxygenation with continuous positive airway pressure, CPAP, and gaseous exchange through high through flow dependent dead space flushing. The dead space is reduced. Yes, it's true that there will be rise in PCO2, but it is very slow. It is around 0.15 kilopascal per minute. It is used in emergency and difficult tracheal intubation, and even in certain surgeries where the surgeon and the anesthetist will share the same area, that is the tracheal field. Those certain minor surgeries can be, short duration surgeries can be conducted with Thrive without using tube. So it is also become, it is also a case of tubeless surgery. So this is the Thrive. Similar to HFNO, there is a blender, air oxygen blender, there is that humidifier, then there is that nasal interface. Okay. But one thing is important is that since the patient is anesthetized, you need to keep the airway open by either jaw thrust or by putting an airway. Now coming to hyperbaric oxygen therapy. If you remember the Boyle's law, which says that at constant temperature, volume of that gas is inversely proportional to the pressure exerted on it. So if pressure doubles, volume is halved. So in emboli, what happened? If you give high pressure oxygen, the volume is volume gets smaller. And that way, the mechanical deleterious effects of the emboli gets lesser and lesser. So this is the principle behind its use in decompression sickness or AR and gas embolism, because it reduces the size of gas bubbles within the tissues and circulation. And the same is responsible for occurrence of pain in sinuses and ears. Indications are AR gas embolism, carbon monoxide poisoning, Clostridium myositis and myonecrosis. A very important emergency use is in case of central lateral artery occlusion. If it is given very early within 30 minutes, it gives very good results. Necrotizing soft tissue infection and severe anemia where the PO2 increases. So this is our hyperbaric machine. It's a single place one. All those multiplexes are also available. Contraindications are few. One is untreated pneumothorax. Another important contraindication is if the patient has got blocked eustachian tube, then he might have damage his middle ear, or use of doxorubicin, because you know doxorubicin increases the effects of oxygen toxicity. Adverse effects are middle ear barotrauma in cases where the eustachian tube is blocked. There may be, because of this, there may be ear pain, tympanic hemorrhage, Seurat effusion and rupture. Management is by auto insufflation, but commonly what we do is that we use decongestant, or sometimes we have to use tympanostomy tubes also. Now coming to the last part of my talk, the side effects of oxygen therapy and oxygen toxicity. It often occurs when we deliver oxygen of F5 to more than 0.5 for more than 48 hours. Initially, we must have observed that even if you use nasal cannula for a long time, there's nasal oral dryness, nasal bleeding, loss of taste and smell, claustrophobia with the mask, gastric insufflation, and features of oxygen toxicity. There is also absorption atelectasis. You know that we don't conduct cases with 100% oxygen. Why? Because if you use 100% oxygen, the entire oxygen within the alveoli will be absorbed and the alveoli will collapse, leading to atelectasis. Also, high oxygen concentration depresses the respiratory drive, particularly in patients of COPD. And this makes them prone to hypercarbia, carbon dioxide narcosis, and finally respiratory failure. Now, little bit about the pathophysiology. How does this oxygen toxicity happen? When there is too much of oxygen, it promotes the release of oxygen-free radicals. These oxygen-free radicals, they damage the alveolar cells and attack the granulocytes. Now, these granulocytes, they produce vasoactive pro-coagulatory and pro-inflammatory cytokines. And these cytokines, they increase the pulmonary vessel permeability, and so there is the risk of developing pulmonary edema. And if it continues, there'll be fibrogenesis and permanent lung damage. And finally, there's apoptosis and death of alveolar cells. Now, if you notice, then the pathophysiology is of very similar to that of ARDS, because in ARDS also there is pulmonary vessel permeability and risk of developing pulmonary edema. And it's true that the clinical features of oxygen toxicity is very similar to that of ARDS. So if you're giving high oxygen concentration to patients of some lung disease, then after some few days, you'll not know what is happening. Why is he deteriorating? Is it because of oxygen toxicity or is it because of ARDS? Because the clinical features of both are same. Also, when there's high oxygen concentration, it causes systemic vasoconstriction. Both cerebral and coronary vasoconstriction have been documented, and you would know that patients of myocardial infarctions who were given oxygen had higher mortality than those who were not given oxygen. Retinal damage can also happen because of retrolental fibroplasia, especially in the preterm babies. It may also lead to vision impairment or loss of vision. There might be progressive myopia, but good thing is that this progressive myopia usually gets reversed within 6 months. And there is accelerated development of nuclear cataract. So the red flag is that we must avoid 100% oxygen for more than 12 hours, 80% oxygen for more than 24 hours, 60% oxygen for more than 36 hours, and we should not give 50% oxygen for more than 48 hours. If you have to give this, try other methods like increasing PEEP instead of giving high oxygen. So while administering, remember that oxygen needs to be treated like a drug. Be clear about its indication, dose means the fraction FiO2 or the number of liters of oxygen that you are giving per minute, mode of administration, type of mask, nasal prongs, etc. How long to administer? It should not be a free, open-ended one. Give oxygen. You should know how long to give and when to stop and prevent overdose, that oxygen toxicity. So you should always treat it like a drug, and like drug, you prescribe oxygen with all these factors in your prescription. Maintain a record of date and time the oxygen was started, how it was delivered, oxygen concentration, the flow rate, because then only know whether the patient is improving or is deteriorating. Patient observation with vitals and any change in the vitals, because that will tell you whether you need to go to use some other device. And importantly, you should include the oronasal care, because there is often drying of the oronasal care or nasal pathway. So there should be oronasal care to the nursing plan. So to finally conclude, treat oxygen as a drug and use it accordingly. Choice of oxygen therapy device depends on various factors, and you should take them into account while choosing a particular device, so that the patient gets maximum benefit from that particular device. A high performance device may also turn variable performance device if the peak inspiratory flow rate is very high and oxygen toxicity is a real threat. Thank you, friends. Thank you, sir.